Hello, and thank you for being here with us. You are invited to join us every Sunday here in person at 9 and 11 a.m. or live online at 9 a.m. on Facebook and YouTube. Whether in person or from home, we are so thankful for every opportunity we have to worship with you. God is doing incredible things here at Word of Life, and we are so honored that you chose to be a part of that today.
I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, 'cause you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. A cloud by day is a sign that you are with me. The fire by night is the guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, come on, church. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on. 'Cause you have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh.
Come on, we believe. Church! Woo!
Father, you are so amazing. Word creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. With the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea to sky, from the rivers to the mountaintops, we'd hear Christ magnify. Come on together. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Yeah. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry, and then strong and worship you, and if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by my feelings, I hold fast to what is true, and if the cross brings transformation, you can hang me there with you, cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. When you return in glory, all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be saying, my soul will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified. Thank you. sing our love song to you. You are holy, you are righteous. There is nothing, there is no one that can compare to you.
You are the blessed Trinity.
Thank you. today, God. Come on, declare that in your life, that He is for me. Come on, He is for me. Come on, speak that out over your life. He is for me. God, You are for me today. Thank You, Father. What mountain can stand in the way with that promise? Come on, allow Holy Spirit to bring that revelation to your heart today. As we're going to see in just a minute with communion here, the promise that Jesus spoke over His disciples, which He spoke over us, to fear not, but be strong and courageous. Because He is for us. He is for you. No matter the battle, no matter the struggle, no matter what seems to be facing in the natural. Man, aren't you thankful today that you serve a God that is above our natural? When storms seem to rage, the comment doesn't come out, "What are we going to do? What's happening? We're not going to make it." Wouldn't that have been something if Jesus did that? Oh. He said, "Wait a minute. Why'd you wake me up? I told you we were going to the other side. Why'd you wake me up? But the storm, is it scary? The bigger, yeah. Stop looking at the storm. Rest in My promise. But you don't know what the doctor said, but you don't know what's happening. No. Like, hey, I've healed you with My stripes. It's settled. It's done. Man, He is for you. He is for you. Just close your eyes and just speak that over your heart right now. Make it personal. God, thank You that You're for me. No matter what I see in the natural, God, You are for me. And You are so much more. You are so much greater. Thank You, Father. Like I said, we're about to enter a time of communion. If anyone didn't get communion, if you wouldn't mind just raising your hand, the ushers will come around. Feel free to be seated or standing. And I just like to encourage everyone just to be in a posture to receive. Just putting yourself in a posture to receive from Him. We were asked to take communion today, and I don't know if you guys can bring me a pulpit. I don't. Or if Kevin, you just want to stand up here like this. I'm kidding. Don't do that. That'll be really weird. Let me tell you something. During it was Christ be magnified. This is where things work for me. I know a lot of people get kind of turned off with some of the lights and some of the, you know. But during that song, we have a young man. His name is Matthew that runs our lights. Everybody give a big hand for Matthew. seeing young people involved in that kind of way, just pouring out their heart, it's absolutely incredible. And serving in ministry when, I mean, he's a young teenager, you know, and to be pouring his life. Every time I turn around, that young man is up here in this room just programming, learning, pouring out his heart in worship back there. Thank you, guys. Pouring out his heart in worship. I believe allowing Holy Spirit to minister in him and through him, even through things like lights. It's amazing. But he did something on Christ Be Magnified to when we came into the chorus. See, this is why I want to shine lights on you guys so that you can feel how I feel. When that came on, he lit these bad boys up and my eyes were closed and I sang that line, oh, Christ be magnified. Let your praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And he lit those bad boys up. And Holy Spirit just spoke to me and it said, all of heaven is shining on you right now. I don't see lights, I see his love. I don't hear music, I hear his promises. That are spoken over me. And it's this promise that's been spoken over each and every one of us. And we've been asked to take communion as a church. And I'm all for National Day of Communion and National Day of Prayer and all of this stuff. But man, we have to get to a point to where it's not something that we do because somebody out there somewhere organizes a big movement, and that's great, that's wonderful. It was awesome to see what a million plus people packing the streets in DC. And I have to believe that it's more than just for a man. I have to believe that it's for righteousness to invade this nation. It's for Christ to be magnified in me and through me. And so they organize these things and they're awesome, but I said to someone, I said, what if our life in our relationship with God wasn't about events? Where would we be personally, in our families, in our relationships, even in our country? If communion with Father God was just the very core of who we were. If my people would humble themselves, that are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, I will heal their land. And it's great that we get all together and we get all hyped up and our man's not winning on mainstream media, so we're gonna buckle down and all of a sudden and start praying. We haven't prayed for 3.5 years, but all of a sudden, man, we're wearing out the carpet beside our beds. What if that carpet had been worn out for a long, long time? Because of our just communion with Father God. as Jesus sat down with his disciples, and this was, I don't have communion. Can somebody give me communion? Oh, that'd be good. Can you open that for me? That'd be great. Thanks, guys. He's with his disciples, and he's comforting his disciples, and he says, don't worry or surrender to your fear. Notice that, your fear. In the beginning of chapter 14, he says, you've believed in God, now trust and believe also in me. And he's speaking, prophesying over, and Thomas comes in and says, but Master, where are you going? We don't have a clue. And he said, ah, no, you do. Well, we don't know the way. And he said, well, actually, you do. Because I am the way and the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So he's laying this down, and Jesus prophesies the Holy Spirit. And I love this, is when he prophesies the Holy Spirit, and he goes on and he says, whoever passionately loves me will be passionately loved by my Father, and I will passionately love you in return. Get this, and I will manifest my life, his life, in you, in us. And then he moves on to verse 27 in chapter 14. And we just sang these songs, Christ be magnified. And as we sang in that last song, the blessing, and the Lord bless you and keep you, may his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may his what? Give us his peace. And here's what's amazing about that. Is because in verse 27, Jesus is saying this to his disciples. It says, I leave the gift of peace with you, my peace. It's not natural peace. And he goes on to say that because I believe in that moment they looked really confused. And he said, it's not the kind of fragile peace given by this world, because that's what they were reaching for in the moment. They were like, hey, I'm still hoping for that. I'm still hoping that, you know, that you kind of just come in swinging with that sword now in the natural side of things when this can all be over. And he's saying, no, it's so much bigger than an event. It's so much more than a single moment, but I'm gonna transform your life forever. I'm gonna transform from the moment you wake up in the morning to the moment you go to bed. I'm gonna transform every hour and every minute and every second of every day, because I'm not just giving you peace for a temporary event. I'm giving you my peace, which is eternal. And he's saying this, that I leave the gift of peace with you. It's my peace, not the kind of fragile peace given in this world, but my perfect peace. And he goes on to say, do not yield. He said, don't take on your fear earlier, but now, because he has spoken his word, the word of life. And if you jump over in chapter 15, it says, the words that I've spoken over you have already cleansed you. Because now there was a shift. Because revelation, knowledge, and truth was now being birthed within their hearts. And now all of a sudden it says, don't yield to fear, because it's no longer your fear, because I've not only taken that away, but I have conquered and defeated that fear. And you no longer have a spirit of fear, but one of power, love, and a sound mind. Why? Because you have me and you have my perfect peace. And he says, don't yield to fear or be troubled in your hearts. Instead, be courageous. Be of courage. Move forward in boldness, because I have spoken to you and given you life. But I love when he talks about peace. And if you look that word up in the Greek, that word peace, then he's saying, and this is what's so amazing, because people come at it and say, well, you know, healing's not for today, or this isn't for today, or you know what? No. I want to tell you what Jesus said here in this moment when he said that I'm leave you the gift of peace. As he's sitting down and breaking bread, saying, this is my body, which is broken for you. This is my blood, which is shed for you. I'm leaving you peace through communion, the natural communion that we have. But he's leaving us peace because he's saying that the veil is about to be torn, and you can now enter my presence boldly. You can dwell there. It's no longer
an event that someone that measures up can come in and once a year and make things right for a nation. He's saying that my one event that I'm about to go on, this one event on the cross is going to open it up forever. And it's no longer going to be about an event, but it's going to change your life, every ounce of it, for all eternity. He took something to where it was only an event, to where the priest could go in once a year into the Holy of Holies. And he traded his one event so that we could walk in him, constant communion, the way that we were designed always from the very beginning. And so he says that I leave you my peace. And this is what peace means in the Greek when you study it out. He says that I leave you the gift of peace, my peace. He's saying, I leave you this gift of peace, meaning health, welfare, prosperity. And if that didn't cover it, it goes on to say that this word peace means in every kind of good. Man, that changes things. Changes everything. To say to God that you are for me and in my life, regardless of the fire that's seven times hotter, regardless of what I see in the natural, regardless of on the mountaintop or in the valley, God, you are with me and you are for me, and I have your promise of health and welfare and prosperity in every kind of good. Every kind of good, every kind of good. And he laid it out. And he said, do this in remembrance of me. What are we remembering? The gift that was given to us. Health, welfare, prosperity, and every kind of good, spirit, soul, and body. That's so good. That's how we can stand in confidence and know. Saying, Father, thank you. You're amazing. And he's saying, so remain in life union with me, for I remain. I remain. It's a promise. He remains in life union with us. And get this. This is where healing, life, abundance, every kind of good, this is where it dwells from. In his presence. Communion with him, not an event, but a lifestyle dwelling in Father God, resting in his presence, because it says, I am the sprouting vine and you are my branches. As you live in life union with me as your source, when we're not communing with Father God and we're running to this financial thing or this thing over here or this thing over here, when all of a sudden something hits and we start Googling what it's all about, that's not God as our source. But coming to the Word of God when something hits and saying, God, what have you said about it? What has my source said about it? We get so concerned because we want to see the fruit pop out on the end. And he's saying, it's more about my life flowing through your branch and seeing you grow. And when you do that, when you just rest in me, when you stay connected to me, it is a promise that says fruitfulness. What is that fruitfulness? Health, welfare, prosperity, and every kind of good. Fruitfulness will stream from within you. How does it come from within me? Because greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. Holy Spirit dwells within us. And the one that raised Christ from the grave dwells in us, and he will now quicken our bodies and our lives and everything we put our hand to. Fruitfulness will stream from within, but when you live separated from me, you are powerless. That's why I never want communion. It can never be just an event.
It's got to be who we are. And when we rest in that, fruitfulness, health, life, abundance, peace, prosperity, every kind of good will stream from within you. You, believer, it will stream from within you. So he sat down with his disciples and he took the bread. And as he took the bread, he gave thanks for it because he knew what it was all about. And he said, take this and eat your fill. God never runs dry. His presence never runs dry. He's saying, as you come in and sit down at the table that I have prepared for you, yeah, but there's enemies all around me. No. Don't look to them. Look at me. Come, eat your fill. Eat your fill. Allow your life to be overflowing in all of those things in this perfect peace. Allow your life to be overflowing. And as we come and we say, Father, I'm not seeking healing today. That would be great. That's wonderful. That's awesome. You've promised it. That's amazing. But I'm not seeking healing. I'm not seeking blessing. I'm not seeking favor. I'm not seeking abundance. Father, I'm coming into your presence. Such an honor to be here. God, strip everything else away. Strip everything else away so that I am back to the heart of what it's all about. That I have no hidden motives. I have no hidden agenda because, Father, you know every part of my heart. Father, I'm just here at your table to be with you. I'm just here for you. And when we come to that place, I believe that that's what it's all about making Father God our source. And in that moment, without hidden agendas, without other motives, saying, Father, it's all about you. That is when we see his fruitfulness abound in all that we are. So, Father, I thank you that you gave your one and only perfect Son for me today, that I can come dwell in your presence. And I thank you that in your presence there's fullness of joy, but I thank you that you are always an overflow God. I thank you that here and now in your presence that there is healing, that there is life, that there is abundance, that every good and perfect gift that comes from you, and you just long to lavish it upon us. Thank you for giving your Son, Jesus. Thank you for finishing the work on the cross. And Father, I thank you for the healing and the life that is flowing in this room. I thank you for the prosperity and the wisdom and the understanding that is being known. But Father, I thank you most of all that you are here. And I thank you that there is no longer a divide. And that every moment of every day, I can come to you in my raw, real way and just be with you. So, Father, let us move past an event today and let this be all about the real meaning, you. your presence, communion, fellowship with you. As we receive this broken bread, we receive the broken body of your Son, Jesus, by faith. And all that you've spoken and declared into it, we receive it now. In Jesus' name. And on that same night, he took the cup. And that's what's amazing, is that he tore the veil, and it came now that the veil was torn. But it all came through the blood of Jesus, that we can now enter boldly and freely into the presence of God. Because now, what can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. The blood of bulls and goats couldn't do it. Our right actions couldn't do it. Our right living could never do it. We can never earn up to it. But it's the blood of Jesus that has been washed over us, and that we are perfect, and we are holy, and we are righteous. We are redeemed. We are white as snow. We are as Jesus is here now in this world. Thank you, Jesus, that you shed your blood. You shed your blood. You shed your blood in the great exchange of our filthy rags, for your perfect righteousness. And I thank you now for the inheritance of the righteous that has been spoken over us, that has been declared over us. And as we do this in remembrance of you, we are putting ourselves in your presence today, God. Again, no hidden motives, no hidden agendas. We're just coming to you in thankfulness, saying thank you, Jesus, for the price that you paid so that I could forever know you and walk in you. Thank you. We worship you and we praise you. And when you're ready, receive it by faith. Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you. I thank you for the hearts and lives that have been changed today, God. I thank you that we are in a church that goes beyond religious games, but we come and we are here today, Father, for you and only you. And I thank you for truly touching hearts and changing lives in this room today, for bringing revelation beyond our understanding, for truly doing what only you can do, God. And I declare your life and your abundance. And today, Father, I thank you for your health, for your perfect peace, for your joy that passes all understanding. I thank you for every good gift that you have lavished on your people today. And I declare it over each and every one of their lives, over each and every family, over each and every household, over each and every business here today, over everyone represented in everything that they put their hand to, that Father God, you would be overflowing so much in their lives that they couldn't contain it, but they would just give it away because they have so much life that it just has to flow over. So I declare that life, I declare that peace, I declare that abundance, and we say amen in agreement with you today. We say amen that we're lining our lives with your promise. We say amen that it's all about you and your word, in Jesus' powerful name. And again, we say church, amen and amen. Come on, give him a shout of praise today. God is so good and he loves you so much, and he is for you today. He is for you today in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, come on, turn to four people, give him a high five, a hug, a handshake. Let them know you love them. Let them know Jesus loves them. There's truly not a better place than any of you could have chosen to be than right here, because God has such an incredible plan for each and every one of you. Keep your heart open, and I know your life will never be the same. Thank you so much for being here today and worshiping with us. We're family here at Word of Life. So welcome home, church.
Thank you again for being here today. We have announcements about what else is coming up that play before and after our services, so don't forget to listen for those. We will be having a Thanksgiving Eve service on Wednesday, November 25th. Return to Bethlehem, a new drive-through experience, is happening on December 4th to the 6th. And like we previously announced, shoeboxes for Operation Christmas Child are due on Sunday, November 22nd. We heard from Serena last week about her incredible mission trip experience, and today we have two more friends sharing their missionary experiences as well. We love hearing about all that God has done and is continuing to do, and we encourage you to get involved too. Whether by contacting us with interest in participating on mission trips yourself, or by filling a shoebox for Operation Christmas Child. Operation Christmas Child is an amazing opportunity for us all to reach children and families around the world with the gospel. It's an opportunity for us to participate in missionary work without ever having to leave home. You have the potential to change lives with the love of Christ wherever you are and wherever you go.
A few years ago, Jim Harris from Relevant Expeditions came to our church. And after the service, me and him were talking. We had a few things in common. And he asked me if I wanted to go on a mission trip to Cambodia. There, I worked on two different sewer issues. He was having trouble with at his children's homes, and I helped him repair them. And when I was there, I happened to text Jason to see if this might interest him about coming on a mission trip to Cambodia.
So I received a text while I was there. I don't know, it was probably the third or fourth day while I was there. And he sent me a picture of a wall that needed repair and wanted to know if I could maybe come back the following year and help them rebuild the wall. So obviously I said yes. I actually was kind of, I said, you know, I'm jealous that you're there without me this year, but obviously I ended up going with him the following year.
In January of 2019, we went back to the children's home and we helped build a security wall around the children's home there.
You know, we went there to work on the wall, to do some maintenance work on the children's home, to support Jim as far as helping him do some maintenance work, stuff that he couldn't get done or stuff that he couldn't pay for. We actually helped raise money for the wall. But the kids, the first time that I met the kids when we went out that day, it's hard to explain. I have children myself, so, but when you're around kids that, you know, don't know who their parents are, don't know when their birthday is, Jim has told us stories about how some of these kids he's found, just they found wandering around in the jungle. That breaks your heart. And I don't care how tough you are, you see those kids looking at you and they chase you around like you're their father, you're your best friend. They've never, you know, a lot of them have probably never even seen an American before. But they were just so happy and grateful that we were there. Every time you turn around, they were there, you know, pulling on your shirt and wanting to play with you and not wanting to leave, wanting us to leave at the end of the day. But we went there to help them, but they had a deep impact on my life. And Adam said, you know, when we were there this year in February, the day we left, our last day with the children at the children's home, I weep like a baby. And I'm not a big crier, but I couldn't stop crying. We were sitting at the airport and I couldn't keep myself composed. I didn't want to leave because I felt bad for leaving them because they've not had anyone in their lives. You know, the parents are gone, no family. So it grows on you. You know, the United States is my home. Pennsylvania is my home. But I love Cambodia, and I love those kids. And like Adam said, I miss them dearly.
When we were building the security wall, it's because the children's home that we were working at is 45 minutes from the biggest child traffic area in Cambodia or in Asia. And we don't want the children to get stolen from the children's home. But anyways, when we were working, building the wall, the kids are in amongst you. They wanna, you know, they wanna help lay bricks, they wanna lay the mortar, and you know, you just kinda like end up loving them as their own because they're really easy to love. They need attention, and you know, it's nothing for you to put your arm around them and have them close to you. In 2019, we had a golf outing, and we were going to sponsor two wells with the money that was raised with the golf outing to the relevant expeditions. So we had the honor of going to dedicate these two wells that our golf outing raised the money for.
Cambodia is a third world country, and it's really bad as far as conditions. You know, food's an issue. It's not taken for granted. You just can't run to Walmart. Water's an issue. Clothing, shelter, all that is not taken for granted because it's hard. Life is hard there. It's hot. It's dry for months during the year, and then this time of year around November, December, it starts to rain, and then it floods, and then the flooding gets really bad. So what little they have, they lose. So, but you know, Jim just sent us some pictures. You know, it's flooding there now, flooded there a couple weeks ago. And you look at the pictures and the people have lost everything. You know, the water's up to their neck and they're trying to push what little they have to a dry area. And they have a smile on their face. But it's hard to even fathom the fact that in spite of all that's going on in their lives, they can still find reason to smile. I guess it's, you know, they're happy that they're still alive and they survived this flood.
Well, going on these mission trips is really an incredible thing. You always start out thinking, well, we're going to go over there and do so much work, and you know, we're going to get all this work done, and we're going to help these people so much. But when you leave there, it's like so many of the experiences that you get. The appreciation that you have for where you live, and just the love for the children and for the people that are there. And I would just like encourage everyone to consider going on a mission trip. You don't have to go so far, but the change that happens inside of you is well worth it.
I'm so thankful for the opportunity that I've had through missions.
And I'm so thankful for our church.
Stand with me, church. What an awesome, incredible testimony. I was reminded of a mission trip that I took a number of years ago to Haiti, and it's just so similar. Hot, people have nothing. And oftentimes what little they do have is taken away from them. And so we're so blessed here in America. So very, very blessed. And we have entered into the month where we recognize that we need to be thankful and we need to be grateful for everything that we have. And I always want to encourage a church to be thankful for even the small things. And I think that that shows the greatest gratitude of all. When seemingly it is nothing in the hands of someone else, you are grateful for it. You're thankful for it. I encourage you, always express your gratitude to your Heavenly Father. He never gets tired of hearing it. Father, I just thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for this church, my God. Thank you, Father God, for men and women, young people, oh God, who just continue to see their lives sown as an offering before the living God. Thank you, Father God, for the blessings that you've placed upon us, that you bring through us to bring to others. We thank you, Father God, for even the smallest of things that so many people take for granted. We thank you, Father God, for the taste of an apple and the beauty of the surroundings that we have. We've just come through a season of fall, and the trees are just so gorgeous. And thank you, Father God, that we are able to embrace and see these things, because it's by your mighty, mighty, mighty hand that you bless us. So we continue to declare your favor and your blessing to be upon this church in Jesus' awesome, wonderful, and glorious name. And I thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. And before we're seated and before we have our Word of Life confession, it's something I did in the first service. And because I really believe the Spirit of God dropped this in my heart yesterday, was outside working, doing things, etc., and thinking about the service today, and it was something that I really felt the Lord wanted me to do. And so out of obedience, and of course I questioned, I said, Lord, well, what if nothing happens? What if it's, and I really believe that he said to me, okay, and I don't know if you're like me in this thing, you're trying to weigh this out. Is this God or is this me? Okay, but I believe that there's someone or maybe several people here that need to make a personal, public commitment to Jesus Christ. When I laid that out there in the first service, no one responded. And I really believe that if I'm hearing the Holy Spirit, if I'm doing what God has told me to do, and you don't respond, then you're the one that's disobedient to the Spirit of God, not me. Okay? But I did encourage anyone that perhaps the Spirit of God was speaking to come see me after the service. Sure enough, a woman came up to me afterwards, weeping. I didn't know who she was. She said, Pastor, you were speaking to me. I've been away from the Lord for many, many years. I really feel that I needed to make a public commitment, but I just didn't come up. And perhaps there's someone here right now, that you need to make a public commitment. The only thing that'll keep you back is your pride, okay? So I'm gonna give you that opportunity right now. All the lights are on, yes, people are looking, okay? I gave my life to Jesus Christ in a little Methodist church that I was raised in. When I went up front to give my life to Christ, it didn't matter what people thought. I was raised in that church. I taught Sunday school. I sang in the choir. Did all the things that church sort of wanted you to do. Baptized actually as a baby. Went through membership class. All that. And yet at 19 years of age, I walked down that middle aisle during a service and gave my life to Christ. Perhaps at that moment, it was one of the hardest things I ever did because I felt that people would judge me. People would say things about me. People were looking at me. How can he's a Christian. No, you don't know a person's heart. I was religious, but I wasn't a Christian, okay? And so if there's anyone here today that you know, the Spirit of God's speaking to you right now and you're fighting, you're resisting it, okay, so I want to be obedient to God. It's up to you to be obedient. I want you to just come up front right here now. Just step out of your seat if I'm speaking to you. Okay, step out of your seat and meet me up here. We're going to pray over you. And I believe your life is going to be changed for the glory of God. So if there's anyone, I know I just need to fulfill my commitment and what the Spirit of God is speaking to me. Now you might say, well, I'll do what that woman did. I'll see you after the service. She still hasn't made a public commitment to Christ. You have to understand that. She made a private commitment to me, okay? Hallelujah. All right. Praise God. Anyone else before we pray? Anyone else? Come on. God bless you. God bless you. All right. God bless you. God bless you. It took a lot of courage to do what you did. It took a lot of courage, okay? And I just want you to know, God will honor obedience. He honors obedience, okay? So, amen. It's awesome. Just awesome. Absolutely awesome. We're living in a day, in an hour, where I really believe that there's a great harvest being moved by the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Amen. And amen. Now, whether this is a first-time commitment for you or a public, you've given your life to Christ, but it's a public commitment. The point is you've been obedient to the Spirit of God. That's the point, okay? And I really, that transformation that is taking place or going to take place in your life is huge. It's just huge. All right? We're going to pray with you right now. We're going to pray with you. I think Pastor Shell went out to get some pamphlets for you, a booklet for you, a salvation packet for you. And again, you know, if this is a renewal or this is a first-time commitment or just a public commitment in front of everybody, God's blessing on you. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the obedience of these precious people. I believe that from this moment forward, their lives are never going to be the same again. I believe that with all my heart, my God, in Jesus' awesome name. Thank you for their obedience to the Spirit of God that has drawn them to this place, that has drawn them to this altar of commitment right now. In Jesus' awesome, awesome name. In Jesus' awesome name. Now, for those of you that maybe are making a first-time commitment, I want you to just pray this out. Pray this out loud. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, I yield my life to you right now. I believe that my sin debt is paid. I give you all praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe that from this moment, I am born again according to your word. I receive forgiveness. I receive salvation. I receive the Holy Spirit in Jesus' wonderful, wonderful name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless you. Thank you so much. We have a packet for you. If this is a first-time commitment or a renewal, you want to take this packet and just read some of the material in there. And please get that card back to us. That's very, very, very important that we stand with you in prayer. If perhaps you don't have a Bible, we'll gladly give you a Bible. But I want to encourage you with this. Stay connected. Stay connected, not only to Christ, of course, which is the most important, but what's going to help you stay connected to Christ is staying connected in a local body of believers, okay? Maybe some of you don't necessarily have a home church, so to speak. So talk to me. I can make some recommendations, okay? All right. God bless you. We love you. And please go back to your seats. May the favor of God continue to abound within your life. Amen. Amen. We have our word of life confession. Make your proclamation known into the realms of the heavenlies. Here we go. Jesus, be glorified in my life. Holy Spirit, I welcome your presence. My heart is open to receive the ever-living, never-changing word of God. The word that is changing my life, healing my body, setting me free. My faith is growing and I am living in the favor of my God. I declare it. I believe it. I receive it by faith, for I am blessed again. One more. I am blessed in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Give him one more praise, church. Hallelujah. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. Well, we don't have a whole lot of time right now, but that's okay. I really believe that we've been obedient to the Spirit of God. So we're going to talk about a couple of things. I'm continuing on in this series, The Weapon of Works, The Weapon of Good Works. And my text is found over in Titus chapter 2, starting verse 11, the New King James Version. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Now that in and of itself is huge, is huge. This grace of God that brings salvation has, not will, has appeared to all men. Teaching, or mankind, that should be, or is what it's saying, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, I want you to note that also, because there are certain religions, so to speak, that do not believe. They perhaps consider themselves Christian, but they do not believe that Jesus Christ was God manifest in the flesh. Over in 2 John chapter 1, it tells us that those who do not believe that Christ, which means God with us, has come in the flesh, they are antichrist. That's what the Bible says, okay? So we see right here that the scriptures are telling us that God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, okay, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people. If you're born again, you are purified in spirit. You can't get any more right with God than what you are at this very moment if you are born again. If you've received Christ genuinely in your heart, your spirit has been saved. You were dead in trespasses and sins. That was your spirit. But now you have been quickened or made alive by the Spirit of God. That is your born again spirit, which is now born again in the likeness of Jesus. Okay? That's how this all fits together. Your spirit is born again in the likeness of Jesus. The Word of God is renewing your mind, which is your soul. That's why it's important that you read, feed in the Word of God. You want your soul, the way you think, to change, then feed in the Word of God. Okay? And your body will be, your soul is in the process of being redeemed by the Word of God, washed, is what the Bible tells us, and your body will experience complete salvation at the resurrection of the human body at the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's how it works, okay? Purify himself, his own special, for himself, his own special people who are zealous for good works. Speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority, and let no one despise you. Now we go over into chapter 3, verse 8, okay, because the Bible continues to speak about good works. It's important. But the thing that we need to understand is that our good works are not to glorify us, they are to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the purpose of good works, okay? So we can exemplify, if you will, the nature of Jesus, and that nature is within us. That nature is within us. So our good works need to exemplify the very nature of Jesus Christ that's within us. Titus chapter 3, verse 8. This is a faithful saying, and these things I want you to affirm constantly, that those who have believed in God should be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men. Or mankind. So we've been talking about the necessity of good works as Christians, okay? But the most important thing that we need to understand and remember concerning good works is that good works can never, 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 never bring salvation. Good works can never, never, never bring the blessing of God, okay? So oftentimes we have a tendency to think if we do this, this, and this, and this, then God will shower his favor upon us. Now you need to understand, God has already showered his favor upon you. It's up to you by faith to receive it, okay? Faith does not move the hand of God. Faith only brings into motion, brings into fruition what God has already done. And yet we find ourselves saying, well, if I only had enough faith, if I only had enough faith. And what you're saying is that if I can muster this faith up, then I can move the hand of God in my favor. But God has already placed his favor upon you. He has already anointed you. It's what the Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 1, I believe it is. He's already anointed you. And so everything that God has planned to do, he's already done. And it's up to you and me now by faith to receive it, not to make the hand of God move on our behalf, but to receive what he's already done. So we need to understand that no one can be justified in the sight of God by good works. We cannot earn his healing. We cannot earn his favor. We cannot earn his goodness. We cannot earn his prosperity. These are all things that Jesus Christ has already provided for us. I remember a number of years ago, probably more than what I want to think about right now, after the death of Princess Diana over in England, after her death, a preacher made the mistake, even though it wasn't a mistake, but he made the statement that even if Princess Diana had not received Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior, she would be in hell, okay? Now, even though that is a correct statement, because there is only one way to the Father, and that is through Jesus Christ, the people of England were ready to stone this individual. And why would that be the case? Because that's the truth for anyone. I don't care who you are. You need to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. He's the Savior, saving you from hell, saving you from sin, saving you from darkness. Only one way, Christ. But they were ready to literally, in a sense, crucify this man, stone him. And he had threats upon his life. Why? Because they were taught. They were taught by religion that good works will bring you into heaven. And Diana had many good works. Many good works. But when you're taught that good works earn you favor with God, you're deceived. You're deceived. The Bible says over in Ephesians chapter 2. My pages are stuck together. Here we go. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 7. Here's what Paul says out of the Passion Translation. Throughout the coming ages, we will be the visible display of the infinite, limitless riches of his grace and kindness, which was, not will be, which was showered upon us in Jesus Christ. For it was only through his wonderful grace that we believed in him. Nothing we did could ever earned this salvation, for it was the gracious gift from God that brought us to Christ. So no one will ever be able to boast, for salvation is never a reward for good works or human striving. But religion has driven it into us that if we're good enough, then we can earn the favor of God. Come to church. Give your money to the church. Be as good as you can be. How many times have you watched various programs that are more or less these realistic programs? I like the car shows. And oftentimes they'll say, this was Dad's car, I would just like to restore it on behalf of my father. And I know he's looking down on us from heaven right now. And maybe he is. You know, I don't know about that. I'm not here to judge anybody. But the point is, while they're bleeping out his words, speaking about his father being in heaven, okay, and of course, one does not merit the other. The point is, Dad was a good guy. He was a good father. He was a good husband to my mother. He did good things. He went to church more than Christmas and Easter, a few other times. In other words, Dad deserves heaven. And that's just not the case. You see, if it is the case, what that's speaking of is self-righteousness. That's self-righteousness. And of course, we understand that that will not work. That will not work. It's a transformation, not a conforming. It's a transformation. Religion will teach you to conform. The Spirit of God will transform you, make you into a different person, put his Spirit within you. 2 Timothy chapter 1 says this, Jesus Christ saved us and called us with a holy calling, but none of it because of our own goodness or good works. Romans chapter 3, verse 28 says, we are made right with God through faith and not by obeying the law or good works. And a few weeks ago, I spoke of three particular things that good works or good deeds declare. First of all, it declares our love for the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John chapter 14, if you love me, you will do what I say. If you love me, you will do what I say. Secondly, it declares our love for one another. Jesus said in John 13, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. So if you love Jesus, you will do what he says. And a new commandment he is declaring for you as a believer is to love other believers. And what this does, it brings glory to God. It brings unity into the church, the family of God. So it brings glory to God. Our love for Christ, it shows our love for Christ, shows our love for other believers. And thirdly, it even shows our love for the unbeliever, for the unbeliever. Because Jesus said, love your enemies. Pray for those that abuse you and use you. Do good to those who hate you. I recall mentioning this verse over to a brother who was upset with someone he considered an enemy in his life, just a thorn in his flesh. And I says, brother, the Bible says that we're to do good to those that hate us. We're to love our enemies. Do good to those that hate us. He says, well, I'm going to do some good things for my enemy. I'm going to put him out of his misery. And I said, well, I don't think that's necessarily what Jesus meant. What Jesus meant. The Bible says you are to let your light shine before men, mankind, that they may see your good deeds and what? Glorify your Father, which is in heaven. It's a temptation, I understand. It's a temptation to do good things without sounding the horns to say, look what I've done. Because we want to be recognized as a good person. But that's what the law was reduced by the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Good works were reduced, good deeds were reduced to self-glory. And we need to be very, very cautious, dear ones, that we, in and of ourselves, are letting our light shine, that Jesus can be glorified, that we are the salt of the earth, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5. We are the salt of the earth. And here's what he also said. When the salt loses its saltiness, it's good for nothing. What's that saying? When a Christian is not conveying Christianity, they have lost their salt. They're good for nothing. That's what Jesus said. And so we need to be cautious. We need to be careful that we let our light shine. We keep the saltiness of his presence within our lives. I will conclude with this. How do we keep that light shining? How do we keep that saltiness? I really believe that there's three particular things that comes down to, and don't turn me off when I say this. It comes down to giving, okay? But it's here's the three areas. Giving of your time, giving of your talents, and giving of your tithe. And every one of them is very, very important in the heart of the Father. Let me just share this with you in the sense of giving of your time. A number of years ago, there was a song out by Harry Chapin. Actually, it was 1974. And some of you already know what the song is, The Cat's in the Cradle, okay? This song in 1974 went to number one. I was curious about that. I thought, where did it go on the charts in 1974? Number one, okay? And I thought, it's kind of bizarre because even though it's a nice song, I mean, it's not a great song, okay? And Harry Chapin has a nice voice, but it doesn't have a great voice, okay? But here's why I believe it went to number one. Because so many people could relate to what the words are in this song. Let me give you some of the words, okay? My child just arrived the other day, came to the world in the usual way, but there were planes to catch and bills to pay. He learned to walk while I was away. And he was talking, for I knew it, and as he grew, he'd say, I'm gonna be like you, Dad. You know, I'm gonna be like you. And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man in the moon. When you're coming home, Dad, I don't know when, but we'll get together then, son. You know, we'll have a good time then. Well, my son turned 10 just the other day, and he said, thanks for the ball, Dad. Come on, let's play. Can you teach me to throw? I said, not today. I got a lot to do. He said, that's okay. And he walked away, but his smile never dimmed. It said, I'm going to be like him, you know. I'm going to be like him. Well, my son came home from college just the other day, so much like a man, I just had to say, "Son, I'm proud of you. Can you sit for a while?" He shook his head and said with a smile, "What I'd really like, Dad, is to borrow the car keys. See you later. Can I have them, please?" Well, I've long since retired. My son's moved away. I called him up just the other day. I said, "I'd like to see you if you don't mind." He said, "I'd love to, Dad, if I could just find the time. You see, my new job's a hassle. The kids have the flu. But it's sure nice talking to you, Dad. It's been sure nice talking to you." And as I hung up the phone, it occurred to me, my boy has grown up just like me. My son is just like me. The cat's in the cradle, the silver spoon, little boy blue, and the man in the moon. When you coming home, son? I don't know when. We'll get together then, Dad. You know, we'll have a good time then. Time is extremely, extremely, extremely important. Some time ago, several months, I had heard about some difficulties one of our missionaries was going through. So I texted him because he was really on my heart. And the text that he sent back to me, I simply said, "I love you, I care, I'm praying for you. Is there anything I can do to serve you?" And the text he sent back to me brought tears to my eyes because he said this in a nutshell, "Of all the pastors I know, you're probably the busiest." I don't know about that. He said, "And you would take the time to think about me. You would take the time to text. You would take the time to pray for me." Because my text simply said, even though it was a short text, a brief text, but it simply said, "I care. I love you. I'm praying for you. How can I serve you?" And if you're open to it, the Holy Spirit is able to lay someone on your heart that maybe you haven't seen for a while. You heard that they're going through a difficult time. And the easiest thing to do is just simply avoid the problem. Simply avoid the confrontation. You don't know how they're going to respond back to you. And a text is so non-threatening. They can answer it anytime they want. They can ignore it if they want. Or a card, you could send a card thinking about you. "Love you. How can I serve you? How can I bless you?" I understand it's a dangerous request because you never know what they're going to come back with. But the point is, in most cases, most people will simply say, "Thank you. Thanks for thinking about me. Thank you." Very important that we understand the strength of our time in someone's life. Our talents are simply this. Everyone in here has talents. Everyone. God has placed within you talents, at least one. But the point is, so many in the body of Christ are taking their talents that God has given them, and they will not invest them. They just bury them because they don't have the time, they don't have the patience, too much of a bother. And you see, when you bury that talent, all the other talents were doubled in the lives of the servants. But yours, if you're burying that talent, here's what Jesus said, "You wicked and slothful, lazy servant." Take the one talent off of him. And in some cases, it says even this, "Cast him out into outer darkness where there's weeping, gnashing of teeth." That's what Jesus said. I think it's pretty strong, and I'm trying to absorb exactly how deep this thing goes, but that's what he said. That's what he said. Right now, the coronavirus has taken a toll on our helpers in the children's department. And there's people sitting here in the sound of my voice. You're talented. You're gifted. You could invest in these children with the talent that God had given you. You have a wonderful, pleasing personality that children would gravitate to. I'm watching up here and I'm seeing these young boys using their talent for God. What are they? 12, 13, 14 years of age. And already they're giving of their talents. They're passionate about what they do. What are you doing with your talent? In closing, our tithe, and I'm just making this very, very brief. Our tithe is so important because it comes down to giving. Again, the Bible says the tithe belongs to the Lord. But when you give the tithe into the local body, the local church, what you are doing is supporting these missionaries. Thousands of dollars goes out of Word of Life every year. Thousands upon thousands of dollars to preach the gospel around the world. Thousands of dollars go in to events that we extend out into our community. Thousands of dollars to reach our community for Christ. Break down any barriers that might be there. And it's only by you giving, being faithful in your giving of your time, your talent, and your tithe. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you. Thank you for the faithfulness of these people. Thank you, Father God, for their love for you. We're all a work in progress, my God, every one of us. We're moving from glory to glory. We want to be sensitive to your Holy Spirit, my God. So I'm speaking the favor and the blessing, the sensitivity to the Spirit of God over this body, over this congregation right now, in Jesus' awesome, wonderful, and glorious, glorious name. I speak healing out over them. I speak favor out over them. I speak blessing out over them. That holy hedge of protection to be around them continuously in Jesus' awesome, wonderful, 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 wonderful name. That as we continue to step out in faith, and we continue to push down the anguish of fear that the enemy wants to bring in our lives, we bind him in the name of Jesus and help us to receive the word of the Lord. We are going to the other side. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you again for joining us. We pray you were blessed and encouraged by today's service, and we invite you to join us again next week. Our services go live every Sunday at 9 a.m. on Facebook, YouTube, and at wordoflife.church. We also meet in person every Sunday at 9 and 11 a.m. If you would like to know more about what it means to have a relationship with Jesus, please reach out to us. We have some incredible resources that we would love to share with you that will encourage you and teach you more about God's goodness and his great plans for your life. If God is using our church to change your life and you would like to help us lead people to life in Jesus by giving, you can do so by visiting wordoflife.church/give, or you can text the amount you would like to donate to 84321. Follow along with us on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube if you would like to know more about what God is doing in and through Word of Life Church. Thank you for helping us lead people to life in Jesus. We love you, God loves you, and we are so thankful that you chose to spend time with us today.